amazing. The Holy Spirit wants me to tape, and I don't know what about. What about? But we will do so. It's such an extraordinary day. I don't even know what to say. So maybe the Holy Spirit will speak through me and say something important. The number 44 is suddenly cropping up very intensely, to say the least. And this is really important. There are about five different options for our future, you might say, in this world. I thought of five. Most people, if you live in the United States, we use this as a paradigm for the world. Let's say there's an election coming up. You say, well, this side can win or that side can win. And I say, well, there's a third option, is that the martial law will be declared and the POTUS right now will stay in power. That's a third option, right? What's the fourth option? Fourth option is what? We go somewhere else. we don't stay in this world. So that's the fourth option. Fifth option, the Nyingma masters rule the world. So let us start with this. Like, okay, you're here, you're listening. Nyingma masters ruling the world. So I've been wearing this red hat today. I wore it today and yesterday. And everybody like looking at the hat like, what it says or something, and it's like, I kind of say, why is everybody looking at me? And so finally someone pointed out to me, they says, oh, so Trump sent you his hat, huh? And I say, what? What are you talking about? He goes, yeah, that's Trump's hat. He always wears this red hat. I said, I didn't know that. And so I think everybody's thinking I'm wearing a Trump hat. it says Adidas. It's Adidas golf hat. So it's been interesting wearing this hat around the Bay Area. An extremely interesting day today. I can't even sort it out. It's almost overwhelming. First of all, I forgot my wallet. Then I had to get gas, and I had emergency money, enough to just get some emergency gas. And then I ended up in this, well, probably maybe the most wealthiest place in the world. Some building project. This is extraordinary. This house was just incredible house being built. I mean, it's just wow. The concrete, the amount of concrete and it went down. I don't know how far it went down to the ground. Just a bizarre building project. I came across this beam, and they just point out to me. I said, how long is this beam? I've never seen a beam this long. 44 foot beam. I never came across a 44 foot beam before. July 24th is 2/4, 2/4, 44. In other words, 2/4. I wake up from my nap. I'm so tired. I wake up from my nap. I look at my watch. It's 4:44. The road into this place was blocked off the freeway. I couldn't believe it. I got diverted. Detour. I got lost. I didn't know where I was. It was very, and then something. The day has just been. I'm exhausted from the day. If driving without your wallet, you realize that you're viewed as just your identity and your number and your picture. That's your identity. Without that, I felt like I didn't exist. It was a horrible feeling. Like I don't exist. Now, in the dream I had about almost 20 years ago, I was shown what's going to happen now. I've had several dreams, and I had a 44 Magnum pointed at my head, and they were going to kill me. And I finally said, no, you're not going to do that. I'm not going to die. Okay. So then I was going to be sent to a re-education camp, and then at some point the Dharma King rescued me. Okay, so it seems as though we're at this pivotal time now. The Olympics starts, I think, August 6th through 19th, something like that, in Brazil. So every bit of prophetic dreaming that I've had seems to be converging on this time right now, very much so. people are having breakthroughs. They really are. Spiritual breakthroughs. And I would say, I said, I don't need to die. What is the critical term, need? Don't need. Don't need. Don't need. Do not need, but don't was at five letters, and need is, I mean, sorry, don't is four, D-O-N-T, four, and then need is four, four, four. There's four, four right there. Don't need. Don't need. Don't need to die. What is death? Perception. We don't need perception. We've never needed perception. We've never needed to die. Therefore, we've never ever actually been born at all. None of that's happened. So I'm waiting just for this realization to dawn here. And I'm getting reports from some of us here that great breakthroughs are happening, spiritual breakthroughs are happening. And most certainly they are. So we're in this numinous time right now, very numinous, spiritually numinous time. So I don't know what's going to happen next. I'm wearing this red hat to support the Enigma Masters, which I feel, who should be in charge of the world? I think they should be in charge of the world. I think that tradition has shown themselves to be the most capable tradition in the world in terms of generating, you know, genuine enlightenment, as far as helping us reach genuine enlightenment, the austerity. I mean, they have it all. They've proven themselves. So why are we putting this group in charge of the world or that group in charge of the world? Why not support the Enigma Masters to rule the world? I think everyone would be better off for it, for sure. No question. So the hat is in support of the red hats. They're called the three traditions of Tibetan Buddhism. Enigma, Kagyu, and Sakya are called the Red Hats. And so I've got this red hat in support of the Red Hats, meaning the Vajrayana Buddhists, specifically the Enigma Dzogchenists, who I feel would do, I would like to live in a world that is ruled by them, by the Dzogchenists, Enigma Dzogchenists. That's what I want. That's an option, right? Why not? Why not live in a world that is ruled by the Dzogchenists? We would find that to be an extraordinary helpful situation. So that's why I'm wearing this red hat. The red shirt, the red hat, symbolizes the Dzogchenists. Very cool day here. And again, I don't know what's going to happen. It feels like we're in this sort of transitional mode right at the moment. It's an extraordinarily super positive reaction to the posting on the Anandamayama Facebook page continues, which indicates that it struck a nerve in there. So there's something very much going on with this. I've said the 24th is the tipping point. So we should expect, we've entered into, I think today's like the 20th. Or what is today? It's the 21st. It's the 21st. Wow. So you might be watching this on the 22nd. So I mean, we're right now, we're entering into this phase in the world. It's a new phase. It's a new phase, actually. And the question is, who's going to rule the world? This is the question that's taking place in the world. And I started the day out by realizing that there's two camps, really. And one camp says we need to fix failure. The other camp says we need to just set failure down. Just set it down. So this is a very good way of looking at the our lives, our minds, looking at our beingness, our isness, our experiencing, whatever you want to call it, is what camp do you feel you belong in? Do you want to fix failure or you want us to set failure down? So I started looking at this morning, and it's very interesting because I said failure is failure. That's what it is. And ultimately, failure is simply failure from the very beginning. It's never been broken. So failure's never been broken. So there's nothing to about failure to fix. We want to fail to recognize reality. So we're failing to recognize reality. Okay? So failure is just, again, a desire to experience something. So we're failing to be aware of reality. Okay, so what needs to be fixed about that? It's just an idea. There's nothing to fix about it. Just set it down in favor of the idea of recognizing reality. So now I'm succeeding in recognizing reality. So set down failure and pick up success. And success is not even picked up. It's inherently there. Since reality is inherently there, when we set down failure to realize reality, the realization of reality is just inherently there without us doing anything. Without us having to reach it at all, or attain it at all, or have a viewpoint about it at all. Wow. That was quite extraordinary. One of these, puffball, this little stuff like a down feathery puffball comes from some plant. I don't know if it's a dandelion or whatever. It just came wafting in the breeze right along past me like this, like a ghost, a white ghost, and then went into the sunlight, beautiful sunlight there. Wow. So I believe we need to wow our experiencing right now. And this is something, of course, we all forget about. I forget about it. Have not been doing a good enough job of it. This is the key to success. Instead of being overwhelmed by what's taking place, just accept, wow, this is extreme wow. I'm just going to be very disciplined and sit here. And this is something that all of us can practice. We don't need to fix failure. Okay, there's no need to fix failure. No need to fix failure. Failure is failure. Failure is failure. No need to fix failure. Failure is failure. So at this point, I don't know what's going to happen next, which is so just that's a wow. It's a very wowish thing right now. I don't know what is today, Thursday. Maybe Trump has been nominated by this time. I don't know what it is. It's 6 o'clock Western time. Maybe they're holding it for prime time. This sort of sets the. Sets the scene on stage, doesn't it? For the whatever drama is to take place, it sort of sets the scene. And maybe that's what I'm feeling. It's sort of like the die is cast now. The characters, are cast in a stage production. You have the various central figures show up on, an opera. This side and then this shows up, and then this side shows up, and then you realize, here comes the rest of the story. Yeah. don't need to fix failure. We don't need to fix failure. So there's a lot of profundity now arising very rapidly. So we need to right now sit in the wow and wow it, consciously wow it. That's what I was missing today. Got a little lazy. Consciously wow. That's all of us consciously wow what's taking place. Without thinking about what's taking place, we just have this feeling. Wow, our feeling, our intuitive spiritual feeling. Wow. Now, it's very interesting. I had this package that I had to pick up, and this black man took it out of a truck. There was two of them. They said, "Can you get that?" He said, "I'll get." You know, he's carrying. He said, "Wow, this is heavy, really heavy." And he says, "Do I get a tip? Where's my tip?" And I said, "Ah, man, I left my wallet at home." Well, that's literally true. It's literally true. So I had this interesting answer for him that I literally didn't have any money. He was just joking with me, because it was so heavy. But I carried the package later, and it wasn't heavy at all, actually. It wasn't heavy. So what's going on with that, you see? This construction site had more cars and trucks on anything I've ever seen in my life. It was mind-blowing. And this building they were building was just extraordinary. The amount of work being put into it, I just never see anything like it. What does this herald? Super positivism? Desperately trying to fix what's wrong, fix failure? Okay, failure isn't broken. Failure's working great. So failure's not broken at all. So what do we need to fix about it? Just let failure be failure, and let success be success. Just that we could choose, right? Aren't we free to choose? Sure, we're free to choose. We don't need to perceive. Perception is blindness to reality, is what it is. So the intermediate step back to reality is to perceive we don't need to perceive. Now, you can say it in different ways. We can say, I don't need to fixate any viewpoint, including a realized viewpoint. I don't need to perceive that either. I don't need to perceive God. I don't need to perceive bliss. I don't need to perceive enlightenment. I don't need to perceive inherent spaciousness. I don't need to perceive anything at all. And actually, that is takes us close enough to literally experiencing intrinsic spaciousness. Is you perceive, I don't need to perceive anything at all. That is that's very close to the feeling of intrinsic spaciousness itself. As soon as we think we need to perceive it, we don't see it. So perception is failure. And it works very nicely. So we've been experiencing failure to know reality, at least in a dream. So let failure be failure and let success be success. Let failure be failure and let success be success. So I feel that we're on the verge of some sort of breakthrough. So get ready for a very awkward time now. The day was extremely awkward, one of the most awkward days I've ever had. I literally almost lost something driving, and somebody yelled at me, and I had to jump out and pick it up. And it got routed through a town and an area I'm not used to. It was just a very, very, very crazy, intense day, awkward and weird. So here comes the weirdness and the awkwardness, which is what I, of course, have warned about in many videos, is we're headed for this very weird awkwardness right now. So how do we take refuge from that? I would say we probably have to choose a very weird unawkwardness, a weird, very weird gracefulness. And that it's so non-awkward, it's weird. But that fits right in with the weirdness of the times. So you're going to have either one weirdness or the other. You might as well choose the weirdness of this super grace. So let's, this first time I ever used that term, super grace. Super grace. This weird super grace. This weird super grace. And we can say, yeah, you know, it's weird. Definitely is weird, but it's, I think it's better weird. It's a better weird than the weird awkwardness of the world. I think the world feels very awkward to me right now. It was an extremely awkward day. Including people yelling at me, what are you wearing that Trump hat for? What did he send it to you personally or something? I'm like, oh, what? what are you talking about? I don't know. Super awkward day. Super awkward. Forgetting the wallet, not having money for gas. Thinking that I couldn't get gas. I was going to run out of gas. Plans suddenly being shifted and changed. Yet everything worked out beautifully for me. Jamyang Khyentse Chokyi Lodro indicated. He gave me this. He was able to give me this indication. He says, "Don't worry. I got your back entirely." So even through all this weirdness, nothing bad happened to me. A lot of stuff could have happened. And there's still some stuff I can't figure out. Oh, okay, now I can figure it out. Wow, I was driving on this mountain road, and there was this, it was this real slow traffic, and people like to go fast on this road, or people like to go real fast all the time here. And so I was in the back of the line. There was someone behind me, and going up this really windy mountain road. And suddenly I hear this screech of tires, and this car suddenly zooms around me and then jams in front of me. I said, wow, it's a bright red car. And then this car then does the same thing with the car ahead of me. And it's smoking its tires. You know, it's going like in like third, second, third gear. It must have a stick shift or something. And it must be a hot rodded. It was a Honda, red Honda. It must be hot rodded because he's able to like smoke his tires even when he was traveling along. You know, like it's a very powerful, fast little car. And he'd like zoom ahead of one car and then somehow wedge his way in there. And they're like, but there are like 10 cars ahead of him. So he just keeps picking off these cars, and finally he passes two at one time. But problem was he did it right before this curve in the road, a strong curve. You can't see if there's cars coming or not, really. And I said, wow, that is insane. And so, and then he starts honking the horn at the cars ahead of him. Honk, 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 honk. This is a narrow, windy mountain road. There's some truck or something way up ahead that's slowing us all down. There's nowhere anybody can go. There's nowhere anybody can go at all. And I'm sitting there saying, that's fine, because I'm happy to go slow, because I'm real tired. My mind is all confused and awkward today, and I'm going real slow. I say, oh, thank you. You know, I'm happy. But this car is just like trying to, I don't know what they're doing. I assume it's a guy. I don't. I. You know, women drive very aggressively in town. Men will. You know, only. I think only a man would drive like that, smoking their tires and trying to pass on a windy mountain road, thinking that he's going to get past all these cars. I said, "Why do you just realize you're stuck?" No, he said, "I'm not stuck. I'm going to get past them all." Well, I didn't get angry. I just said, "Wow, this is very peculiar. What does this mean?" And you could smell the burning rubber from his tires, actually. He heated the tires up so much you could smell it in the air. I had my window open, I could smell it. I think what it was an extremely awkward situation, no question about it. Because I was saying, oh my gosh, he's going to have a head-on collision here any moment. Head-on collision any moment, because I think he's going to try to pass on some curve, right? A maniac. What I think it was, what was the Holy Spirit showing me, the world now is going to be in a very, very awkward situation, extremely awkward situation, and people are going to become manic. This guy was manic. I assume it was a guy. This guy was manic. He was manic. Get out of my way! Get out of my way! What? Nobody got out of his way though. So, very awkward situation coming. A stall out. Gridlock, some sort of, and people are going to be great discouragement. In other words, things are not going to be flowing the way we want them to go. Manic situations are going to arise. It's going to be an extremely awkward situation coming up. And the red car may have symbolized the red hats, or it could have symbolized the red Chinese or something. I don't know exactly, but I can't remember. I can't quite remember a situation like that I've ever seen. Somebody deciding that, well, there's 10 to 15 cars ahead of me on this road. I mean, it's hard enough to pass one car on this road, and you shouldn't even. I've seen it happen where a car passes one car. If they have a real powerful car, like a Porsche or something, they just like scream ahead of you and they can do it. But he's saying, I'm going to pass all 15 of these cars. Whoa. So what his mindset was just, cuckoo. Absolutely. So there's something very profound about that. Or it could have just been the Enigma Master saying, we can get past all of this trouble. We're going to get past all of this trouble. Don't worry. Something, I don't know. But you could, so there's this weird, it was a very weird, awkward situation. Then somebody just came back from New York. I talked to him and he was going mountain biking. And he said, I said, you just got to get out and get oxygenated. And he says, yeah, you're exactly right, man. I could tell he was just like, he himself had experienced a really intense, awkward day. And he just needed to get out and exercise and just, wash it out of his system. Wash it out of his system. I could feel it. I could feel it. He had been hit by the awkwardness too. Very intense. I'm still feeling the awkwardness here. Wow. So how about the weird awkwardness, a different kind of weirdness of super grace, like the opposite of awkwardness. It's just super grace. Everything is smoothed out. Super grace, not just grace, but super grace. And that will seem awkward too. So we're right in the sort of the, so it's just counter awkwardness. It's the time of awkwardness now. Or I'm sorry, it's the time of weirdness. It's the time of weirdness. So that this super grace is a kind of weirdness. Like people are used to a certain kind of grace. Like, yeah, I have some grace of God. But this is like super grace. Super grace. And people will say, wow, that's weird. Yeah. And so is the super awkwardness of this is really weird too, right? So, choose which one you want. You're gonna fall into one or the other. So with Trump's nomination in the United States, there's a global awkwardness now of like, what are we going to do? You know, really, what's going to happen now? We thought the future was, you know, pretty much smooth and we had it all figured out, and now we realize, no. Not at all. Not at all. It's going to be an extremely awkward time in the United States and the world. Most powerful country in the world still by far, actually, is United States. Most influential by far. And people are saying, what's going to happen here? What direction, ideological direction, are we going to, the United States going to go in? And is there going to be severe fragmentation in the world as far as other countries deciding they don't want to go that way? Is the United States going to be isolated? You know, what's going to happen with Russia, United States, everything? So everything has suddenly become very awkward, hasn't it? Because we thought we had the storyline, which is we'd all kind of capitulate to the Chinese, which is basically what the storyline of this world is, basically going toward capitulation to the Chinese, and then from there capitulation to the reptilians and a global dictatorship. Now that little fantasy storyline is become very awkward. Because people think that there's no way that Trump can be nominated. That's crazy. You know, no chance. I mean, they said his candidacy was ridiculous. It was a farce. He was just doing it for, you know, to joke. So I think many people in the world thought that he was just doing it as kind of a publicity stunt. And that at the last moment he would back down. I don't even know if he has been nominated. Tell you the truth. And so I think a lot of people really in their hearts thought this is all just a publicity stunt, and at the last second he's gonna say, you know what, folks, guess what, I just did this just, you know, for fun. I don't really want to be president. I really don't want to be your nominee, so I'm going to hand it over to, you know, such and such. I guarantee you there are a lot of people hoping that that's the case. And if he indeed did accept the nomination, then this is going to impact them in a very severe way. And I think they're going to get very frantic. Because the specter of Trump becoming president to them is like the end of the world to them. It'd be the end of the world. Now, for me, I'm very much apolitical. I think I'm a super pragmatist when it comes to this. And I believe the Constitution's a very good document, very, very good guide for governance, United States Constitution. And I don't, what I believe in these checks and balances, and what I don't want to see is any ideological group be in power too long and then get a stranglehold on an ideology and then force everybody into that ideology. So I like this, for my opinion, is the liberals have been in power too long. They're very close to getting a stranglehold on ideology. And so it's time for them to leave office, let the other ideology come in, let them stay in power for 8 years and then go back to the liberals. You need to go back and forth so neither group gets a stranglehold. Okay, this is very important because that is what's dangerous, is one ideological group getting the upper hand and getting a stranglehold and then crushing the other. That's what the Constitution is designed to prevent. And the people, trust the people, say, hey, we don't really want that because, you know, neither ideology is right. And so you get a little bit of free will feeling like, you know what, as long as once we're not being dictated to, free will still in play. All right, so we think we can throw them out and put another party and throw them out, put another. And we're able to breathe the air of free will a little bit in the world. But if one side dominates, I don't care what side it is, conservative or liberal, either side getting a stranglehold on the other is not, pragmatically, is a very dangerous thing in this world. So this is my viewpoint. I'm just very pragmatic about it. And I think this is a very extremely reasonable, viewpoint to have about it all. And just the idea of 16 straight years of the radical liberals, that would crush. That would be just a crushing blow, absolutely crushing blow. We would never recover from that, actually. So it's not a good idea that. Okay, let me see if it's actually happened, because I feel something's happened. I don't even know if it's today, though. Maybe not. I don't know what's going on. See, I really don't follow the news. You probably, I'm sure you know better than I do what's going on. I don't follow the news. Well, it says he is the nominee, apparently. Yeah, just bear with me here. Oh, he hasn't given the speech yet. Okay. So when's he gonna give the speech? Maybe he hasn't done it yet. I don't know. Oh, he was formally crowned on Tuesday. Becomes the nominee. So on Tuesday, but he's gonna give a speech maybe tonight or something. I don't know. Which sets the tone. It sets the tone, right? So that speech is what formally sets the tone and says, okay, this is what we're, our ideology. So it's really two different ideologies clashing about how do we fix failure? Okay. That's why I say let's elect Enigma as president, Enigma master president. I don't know if there are any right now. It seems all the great ones have passed away. I keep trying to find a living Enigma master. If you know of one, let me know. I know there's a lot of Rinpoches around, but I don't have the same feeling at this point towards them as I do the older venerable ones like a Dilgo Khyentse Rinpoche, for instance. Nyoshul Kyan Rinpoche, or of course a Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodro, and there's a number of them. The older generation of Nyingma masters, where they were, in my opinion, they were genuinely enlightened. They had the Rigpa, the clear light, intrinsic spaciousness, the great spaciousness, perception that we don't need to perceive. They perceive we were they were perceiving that we don't need to perceive. We've never needed to perceive. Perception is not a need. Perception is not a need. It's a choice, not a need. Okay, perception is a choice. It's not a need. Okay, this is really so important. And yeah, but don't. Yeah, I can't reach the site. Okay, funny. I don't know what's going on. So whatever. Okay, you get the drift of what I'm saying. Is I think today's the last day of the convention, right? The 21st. Yeah, it is. So he's going to give a speech tonight sometime, and so we're right in that, phase of the ideological, the awkwardness is coming now. It's rising up. So for sure there'll be something to counter this. The super grace will counter this. Okay, super grace will counter the extreme awkwardness that's arising in the world right now. I can't get through the Washington Post. Let's see. Now, there's nothing. I can't get through anything. So people are just having awkward moments now, just like we'll just look. I haven't looked at the news in a long time. Hispanic movie moves from shock to action. Okay, so this is what I'm saying. Megyn Kelly McCain cries when the convention nominates Trump, cries. So people are having these shocked reactions. So this is perfect. This is exactly what we're talking about here. This is what I have said will happen, is they can't believe it really happens. And when it's finally happened, they move from shock to action. Like, they're absolutely shocked. This could never happen. And now they're shocked, and action is coming. And so this super awkwardness is coming. The media, you know, is just like, you know, the sky is falling, the sky is falling, the sky is falling, the sky is falling. So this is what's going to happen in the world now, is there's this collective shock of the world. Now, I'm not shocked at all. It doesn't bother me in the slightest bit. You know? The thing is, they've built up in their minds this idea that they're going to have this cakewalk to global dictatorship, and suddenly it's not a cakewalk anymore, and so they're just stunned by it. They're absolutely stunned by it. You know, cakewalk to global misery, actually global enslavement, getting rid of the notion of free will, institutionalizing the notion that perception is mandatory. Okay, this is the goal. Perception is mandatory. As soon as you say that perception is mandatory, you get rid of the grace of God, because the whole purpose of the grace of God is to point out to us that perception is not a need. Perception is not a need. It's a choice. Okay, and they want to get rid of that completely. Completely get rid of that. And they want to tell us exactly what to do. This is how you perceive. Perception is a need, so it's a science. We can scientifically calibrate it. We can figure out exactly how you should perceive. You got to do this, 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 this. Regulate this, 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 this. And you feel like you've lost your free will. So they thought it would be a cakewalk. And they thought this whole Trump thing was a dream. A lot of people felt that they were it was just a dream, and like a nightmare. And now suddenly they wake up and realize it really happened. So this is, I guess, the news were just reporting, you know, such and such is just shocked, such and such is shocked, and they've got to, like, you know, immediate action. This is like, you know, so look out for, again, immediate action, mob action, riot action, protest action. The activism is going to be extreme here. So a very awkward time. If you're like a non-aligned, non-ideological, super pragmatist like myself, who feels that, you know, hey, you got to balance it out, and that's the best governance there is. That's the best we can do here, is don't let anyone get a stranglehold, ideological stranglehold, okay? So this enables us to practice spiritually a lot better. And if you're like that, you know, it's a super awkward time, because people don't, you know, understand what that's about. They think you must, what do you mean non-aligned, you know? Super pragmatically non-aligned. I don't have any, you know, I'd rather just have a balancing back and forthness, because neither side is right. Both sides believe that perception's a need, but they just differ on how to fix failure. like our failure is failing. Because we keep thinking, I don't know if it's really a need. Oh yeah, we're failing. So our belief that perception's a need is, it seems to be failing. We got to fix the cracks. It's cracking. It's always cracking, isn't it? It always seems cracked. It's a crackpot notion, actually. And so this, the clarity is always arising in us. Okay, clarity is intrinsic to us. So it's always arising, and they're saying something. Oh, it's 40. The video's at 44. This right now. Wow. I just noticed that. Just boom, it hit me. What is going on? Okay, what's going on is super positivity, super grace, super grace, super positivity. But super grace is probably about to make its presence known. That was the dream I had, and Sri Sri Anandamayi showed up in my dream. But what does Sri Sri Anandamayi symbolize? Super grace. The most potent, you know, there's never been a more potent form of grace in the world. I say never been a more potent. I leave the door open to say that there have also been instances of also the same super grace in the world. Absolutely. Jesus Christ, for example. Yeah, absolutely. There has been. But there's never been more, in my opinion, than Sri Sri Anandamayi. It was like perfect super grace. So in the dream, she appeared, and I aligned with her away from the, you know, we're going to fix it, folks. You know, there's something wrong, but we're going to fix it. And so I aligned with, no, there's nothing wrong. You know, failure is not failing. So there's nothing to fix. It's just that, you know, we're failing to recognize that perception is not a choice. I mean, not a need. It's a choice. It's not a need. It's a choice. That's all. It's just a fantasy we're having. So she represents super grace. So in the dream, super grace suddenly showed up right at the point where there was this very, very, well, it's right at this point, actually, in the dream, because there's been this extreme pressure put on the Republicans not to nominate Trump. And in the dream, I felt this, it was 44th president, putting intense pressure on a certain position of saying, we're not going to go along with you. We're going to oppose what, you know, you're not going to dictate to us. And that's essentially what Trump is saying. You're not going to dictate to us. We won't be dictated to in this way. We'll follow the Constitution. And so that's the whole thing that's going on now. And behind the president, finally he had to back down, 44, because he had to back down and realize he wasn't going to get his way. So that's what happened. Trump's now been nominated, and the liberals realize they're not going to get their way under, you know, the barrel of a gun. You know, it's going to go to an election. They thought they could just, you know, crush the conservatives with some ridiculous candidate that had no chance of being elected, who wouldn't galvanize anybody, who's just a patsy, and they didn't get it. So they're furious. And next to the president, from looking at him from my left, was this feminist, this woman, radical feminist, who really was the one telling him what to do. And we know that the president, the POTUS of right now, for number 44, is basically just a patsy, a figurehead for radical feminism. This ideology, which is a front for another, for the reptilian ideology, actually. And to get rid of grace, actually. Real grace. And claim that feminine, quote-unquote, grace is the real grace, and the grace of God doesn't really exist. This is, you know, it's the lie of the devil, actually. It's the devil of arrogance, devil of our conceit, spiritual arrogance. So they were right at the point where this dream showed. And then they said, we need to re-educate you. So you have to be re-educated. So there's going to be a massive campaign probably taking place now to convince people that Trump's the devil, you know. Re-educate us. And it was very intense in the dream. I remember feeling extremely awkward, like this feeling of just the most intense awkwardness imaginable. And I said, I'm going into hell. This is terrible. And suddenly, walking down the street, there was Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. Now, my mistake may have been to equate it literally with her coming back to the world. What she probably meant, since she said she was never the body in the first place, what it meant was super grace is going to show up in some way. Okay, so I finally corrected that likely problem. That the super grace that appeared in this world, that happened to just animate that female form of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, that super grace is going to show up again in the world. Now, it may not even be identified with the person at all, actually. That's possible, right? Very possible. It may happen to many of us, like internally, we may go into this state of super grace, of perceiving that perception is not a need, that we clearly perceive that perception is a choice, not a need. Okay, get this? Do you get this? That we clearly perceive that perception is a choice, not a need. And I would say this is super grace. Based just relative to the normal uses of the term grace, you know, you say, well, somebody arrived to help me, you know, something, you know, happened that helped me out in the world and stuff. That's how we think, you know, grace is generally. But this is a super grace, that literally, clearly perceiving that perception's not a, that perception is a choice, not a need. 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 And in the dream, those who insist upon re-education, they were like just totally taken by surprise, just shocked the heck out of them. And then they were like yelling, cursing us, and like, what are you doing? You know, they're just like shocked and stunned by this. So something very shocking and stunning is going to happen in the world. Super grace is going to make its presence here known. Super grace. And again, it could be us. Those in the world have been spiritually preparing. We get this sudden flowering as we clearly perceive that perception's a choice, not a need. Now, I expect this to happen for myself. I absolutely expect it to happen. And in fact, I practice, it's already happened. And this practice in this way, it's already happened. I already perceive perception. I already clearly perceive that perception is a choice and not a need. I already clearly perceive that perception is a choice and not a need. I already clearly perceive that perception is a choice, not a need. So if we could just practice in this way for a little bit here, very important, because the awkwardness is now here. What happened? It's still taping. It's something. 5144. That is 40. It's like it's getting my attention. 44, 44, 44, 44. Wow. If anyone, what is this 44 situation that's arising now? Just intense 44 situation. Does that mean that 44 is about to make his move? 44th president is about to unleash some sort of extreme pressure on people here in the country? So I already clearly perceive that perception is a choice, not a need. How about a great mantra, huh? Have you ever heard anyone better than that? I already clearly perceive that perception is a choice, not a need. Thank you, Holy Spirit, and all the Dharma Kings and the super grace of the Dharma Kings. All the Dharma Kings have super grace. I already clearly perceive perception is a choice, not a need. Thank you, Holy Spirit, grace of God. I already clearly perceive perception is a choice, not a need. So we have our little speech here. You know, Trump's going to have his speech. Clinton's going to have her speech. But we already have our speech here. So I'm the Dzogchen candidate for president here. Maybe I'll do that. I'll say I'm the Dzogchen candidate for president. Not that I'm a Nyingma master, but I certainly am affiliated with, I have close friendships now and affiliations with that. I feel very simpatico. I would prefer for them to rule the world, their ideology. It's the correct one, really. It's the correct austerity and practice, discipline, actually. So our speech is simple. I'll give my speech right now. Here's the big speech, the flags, all the balloons, everything. Okay, everyone's ready. Yeah, I already clearly perceive that perception's a choice, not a need. Okay, now you say, well, that's pretty brief, you know. I don't know if I can handle the brevity of that. And then I say, well, let's spend like an hour just saying that, okay? I already clearly perceive perception's a belief, not a need. I already clearly perceive perception's a belief, not a need. I already clearly perceive perception is a belief, not a need. And So I accept the nomination of the Dzogchen Party for president, ruler of the world, president of the United States, ruler of the world. Let's get the Dzogchens in power, the Dzogchenpos in power. So I'm the Dzogchenpo Party, running for president on the Dzogchenpo Party ticket. I already clearly perceptions a choice, not a need. Now the road I was on this morning was Marsh Road, and it was shut down, and the whole area was shut down. It was amazing. I've never seen anything like it. I have never seen anything like this. Every freaking single street in the Atherton was the city, was blocked to traffic. Local residents only, no through traffic access. The whole city was blocked. Every street had these signs, closed to through traffic, closed to through traffic, closed to... What in the world is going on that you shut down all traffic like this? Well, I guess the main road was completely shut down, and they said you can't go through this. But the feeling was that everything was suddenly shut down. It's like martial law or something. Now, I would not be surprised if the POTUS pulls a fast one on everybody and declares martial law at some point soon. The specter of Trump winning the presidency, which he certainly could do, is so frightening to those folks on the left who are fretting for the reptilians, really, that they simply are going to pull the plug on the Constitution. They may well do so, absolutely, if they can. And every, you know, you can't get through anymore, no access, you can't do this, can't do this, can't do this, can't do this. I got routed around and I got lost. I didn't know where I was. I had to plug in my GPS to figure out where, how to get there. It's like, wow, tricky. I usually don't use GPS. I just use maps and I can figure out where I'm going. But this one, because of the detour, I got kind of really a little bit, you know, disoriented as far as where I was exactly. Super awkward day. Super awkward day. And this is what's coming from shock to action. And the climate in the United States and globally, I would say, is going to... It could happen in Europe too. It could happen globally. The people are just saying, hey, we got to take action. Our script for the future is like severely threatened. I mean, Trump threatens the script of the liberals to an extraordinary, extreme extent. They have this massive script for the future, and they've all bought into it to the extent what they feel there's no possibility of them of being otherwise, that this is their life. They just assume the future is going to be like this. Because they say, well, any intelligent person would we trust in human intelligence, and this was how it's going to be. Well, trusting in human intelligence is a big mistake. Very big mistake. Trust in the grace of God is the right approach. It's the Dzogchenpo approach. The grace of God says you don't need to fix failure. Failure is just an idea. It was a choice, not a need. And you can set it down. Failing to recognize reality was just a silly little game we were playing. Dzogchenpo Party for the presidency. Our speech is what? I already clearly see perceptions a choice, not a need. I already clearly see perceptions a choice, not a need. Or you can say, I already clearly perceive perceptions a choice, not a need. I already clearly perceive perceptions a choice, not a need. I already clearly perceive perceptions a choice, not a need. Make this your mantra for the next, you know, going forward from now. From now on, make this your mantra. People have mantras like Om Tat Sat Om Mani Padme Om. I already clearly perceive perceptions a choice and not a need. This is a super powerful mantra. Even if you don't quite understand, It's like putting super fertilizer on your tree of faith, the tree of grace. And this will cause the fruit to ripen, you know, very, very fast now. We need that ripe fruit on our tree so we can eat of that fruit. Speaking of eating a fruit, I think I'm going to go to a fruitarian diet now. I blew it at lunch. I had a piece of bread, some Swiss cheese, and peanut butter. And I didn't feel good. I felt lousy after that. Because I vowed that I was going to go to fruit now. And so from now on, it's fruit. I'm going fruitarian diet pretty much. So I'll get some whey protein in there. Maybe some Greek yogurt, you know, but mostly fruit juice and fruits, blended fruit. I'm just going to take strawberries and blueberries and peaches and papayas and whatever fruit I can get and just blend it up and drink it. Blend it up and drink it. Fruit diet right now. Fruit diet, and the mantra is, well, again, I'm going to have plenty of protein in that. And I'll put in some, I have that powder which has all the vitamins and vegetable nutrients in it. What's it? One something. That's really good. I'll use that too. But as far as eating, let it be fruits from now on. I already clearly perceive perceptions, a choice, not a need. Super grace, power shift, here we go. We're power shifting into super grace. That was that dream of Sri Sri Ananda Maharaj suddenly showing up. And I'm able to pinpoint it now. We're at that point that the dream pointed out. We're at that point now. And I believe that the dream was signifying that the president, 44, was putting extreme pressure on all of us to not nominate Trump, the country, and the whole world. He's trying to galvanize the world against Americans, saying, you cannot do that. And but they did it. Americans did it. So this is just now, you know, full freakout mode globally. Super awkward mode. They failed to kill the nomination. They tried to kill the nomination. They failed. Now it's re-education time for everybody, folks. And they're going to be very severe about that. And then suddenly, super grace will show up. I really promise you this. This is what I've, my script for the future is that super, at some point, super grace is going to show up in this world. And you could say that super grace is, I already clearly perceive that perception's a choice, not a need. Now, who thought that something like this would come along? I mean, this just mantra is something like, you know, it's I've never heard of it before. It just, but it's here. I already clearly perceive perception's a choice, not a need. And you can boil it all down to that and just say, you know, I choose super grace. So if you choose the part of the Dzogchenpo party for president, your political action and focus is to do this mantra. We do mantras. We don't give speeches in terms of ideologies. We do this mantra. We say, I already clearly perceive perception is a choice, not a need. So you have your groove now. You see that? You have your groove. Very, very interesting. Some people have their dogs now. That's going to be their groove. And we have our mantra of super grace. This is the mantra of super grace. Okay. Which is our ideology is super grace. And I already clearly perceive perception is a choice, not a need. I already clearly perceive that perception is a choice, not a need. Shut it off, buddy, now shut you down. I mean, the other ideologies, we shut them down, shut down. One of the greatest songs ever recorded. It was Shut Down by the Beach Boys. I listened to that many times today. In fact, I sang a lot today. And I actually hit the high notes on Fun, Fun, Fun. I've hit them a number of times recently, but I can only do it, but I can't do it all the time. It's just sometimes my voice can go really high, other times it can't at all. When I really sing loud and strain my voice or get, you know, I lose the high notes. Like it's early in the morning time when I haven't sung, then the voice is higher. And I can hit the high notes of Brian Wilson, you know, woo, woo, fun, fun. I was able to hit those a couple times. Really, it's like, wow. And I could sing the high notes, all this stuff, but then later on, couldn't. I couldn't at all. My voice dropped down. But I was singing Shut Down. I was singing it really good, perfectly, actually. Over and over and over, I sang the song, just nailing it, exactly right there, perfectly with Mike Love singing that song, Shut Down. What a song. It's just some of those Beach Boys songs are just, you don't know where they came from. I mean, it's just like the different, like, wow. It's just got some sort of feel to it that's just very different, very unique. I'll be able to sing those songs now. When I grew up to be a man, I sang that to a beautiful song. Help Me, Rhonda. All those songs. I was singing a lot of songs today. Singing them pretty doggone well. Not great, but loud. So voice is coming along. It's not great at all, but it's coming along. I can sing. I can sing along. I'm so tired. I had no inspiration, so I'm very, very tired. Maybe the workout I did yesterday was just this ginormic workout. And we hope that you're all aboard here, the Dzogchenpo Party for President. And we have our slogan, which and our ideology is what? Super grace. And our slogan is, I already clearly perceive perception's a choice, not a need. I already clearly perceive perception's a choice, not a need. Now, how many are going to join this Dzogchenpo Party? I'll do a Facebook page on it, Dzogchenpo Party for President. And I'll if nobody's going to run, I'll run. I cannot wait around. We got to nominate our. No, where's our nominee? I've been waiting. Where's Dzogchenpo, who's our nominee? Maybe they said, you're it. You're the nominee. What? Okay. The Dzogchenpo Party for President. For presidency. What should be the good Facebook page? What's the name of the Facebook page? Dzogchenpo Party for President. Or Clarity Ross for President. I don't know. You did tell me. I don't know what to say. And I'm running under the Dzogchenpo Party as the Dzogchenpo Party for presidency. And our slogan is, our ideology is super grace, and our slogan is, I already clearly perceive that perception's a choice, not a need. I already clearly perceive perception's a choice, not a need. We'll see what happens. It's interesting, isn't it? It's an interesting development. Our ideology is simple, super grace. And super grace is expressed as, I already clearly perceive that perception is a choice, not a need. And we just stick to this. It's very simple. We don't give any stirring speeches, to stir up the people. We gotta do this and fix failure. Failure is failing. Terrible at failure is failing. No, failure is not failing. I mean, it will continue if we want failure. We'll continue to not see reality. Sure. But it's always inherently failing because reality is real, and it's inherent within us. Freedom is inherent, can never leave it. So we can overlook it as long as we want. We can experience failure for as long as we want, but it will never be permanent as an experience, because no experience is permanent. I mean, everything is permanent in that we always can choose it. So, but it will never be exclusive. You might say failure will never be attain exclusivity over our mind at all as an experience. There's a better way to put it. So I already clearly perceive perception's a choice, not a need. Yeah, typical. If I do this, nobody's going to go to the Facebook page. Or anything, right? I mean, zero interest. But this would certainly give people, an alternative focus for the awkwardness of the times, wouldn't it? Maybe we can all wear red Adidas hats. Nice hat. I got it super discounted. It's amazing. I went to the store. I felt I need to go there and get the. And there was this hat, and immediately I've been looking for a red hat, and immediately I said, "Ah, that's the one." And it was discounted, heavily discounted. And then when I bought it, it was even discounted even more. And the guy said, "Man, you're getting all the good deals today, man." It was just like, "Oh, amazing deal." I like $12 or something. This is a good hat. This is a really nice golf hat. And white with red is perfect. White symbols the center Buddha family, the five colors of the Buddha, four five different Buddha families. That was interesting. The sound of leaves scuttling along, and in the center is the white color. And I've always identified with this white, white color. The candidacy, our colors will be just white. White and red are our colors. White and red. Okay. And we also wear black just simply as an accent. Occasionally, you might have that because this represents we're still in the world here. Okay, we're still using perception. So the black means we're still using perception. The red implies the vividness of our clarity. And the white signifies we're clearly already clearly perceiving that perception is a choice, not a need. So oftentimes the white predominates. Sometimes the red can predominate. That's fine. But we don't want the black predominating. That's more of an accent color, okay? It's yeah, we're still perceiving. Okay. That's what black signifies. Black signifies darkness. Perception is really darkness. It's blindness, actually. It's blindness. But we're not trying to get rid of the reason why the black accent's there, we're not trying to get rid of perception, okay? No, we're not. So we're not anti anyone here. We're not anti anyone. We love everybody. We love everyone. We know we're all part of just one spiritual family. And all these silly squabbles we're having are just squabbles between siblings. You know how you grow up and you have these squabbles with siblings? And you get over it, okay? It's you for at least most of us. Most of us do. Some don't. But it's that kind of thing. You tussle, you have squabbles, and then later on it's like, oh, it's okay, forget it. We were just joking around. So all this conflict in the world are just squabbles among siblings. And later on you realize, oh, that was much about nothing. And we're all one perfect spiritual family. This is what we realize. So I'm running for president as a nominee of the Dzogchenpo Party. I nominated, well, maybe we'll say Longchenpa nominated me, seconded by Jamyang Khyentse Choegi Lodro. It's I'm running for the president as the Dzogchenpa candidate for president. And our ideology is super grace. Our slogan is our guiding principle can be stated. Our slogan is, I already clearly perceive that perception is a choice, not a need. Like Trump's slogan is, "Make America Great Again." That's our make a gear. So our slogan is, I cl already clearly perceive that perception is a choice, not a need. I don't know. This is a pretty outre idea, huh? Oh, ooh la la! I don't know. I might do it. Don't put it past me. It's worth it. It's worth trying, right? I mean, we need some sort of galvanizing idea. It's more than an idea, isn't it? It's some grace. It's super grace. It's we need super grace to somehow turn us in that direction. And realize that too can be an ideology while we're still here in the world. We have this ideology of super grace, and it's expressed as, I already clearly perceive perception is a choice, not a need. And it's really that simple. As I've said Or we could say one insight settles it all. Maybe the our slogan is one insight settles it all, and our speech is simply to say, I already clearly perceive that perception's a choice, not a need. That's our stump speech. So our stump speech, the boilerplate stump speech that the candidate always gives is, folks, I already clearly perceive that perception's a choice, not a need. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hari Bol, Hari Bol. All homage to those who fly the victor's flag, and various, blessings from all the great wisdom traditions and super grace traditions in history. There's been, a number of super grace traditions based on super grace. Dzogchen Po is certainly one of those. Dzogchen Po. I don't know if to figure it out. Dzogchen Po. Dzogchen It's one of the two. Either one, maybe you want Po or Pa. So, one insight settles it all. I already clearly see perception's a choice, not a need, and that's the insight. It settles it all. It settles it all. Total redemption for us. Total redemption. Now, fundamentalist Christians will say that, that they invited Jesus into their heart and he washed them clean of all sins, which is really saying they invited the invited the realization that perception is a choice, not a need. They don't articulate it that way. They don't articulate it that way. They go on they have a different way of articulating it, which is fine. I like a pragmatic description that sort of clarifies it. It's not an insider thing, really. It's just I clearly perceive that perception is a choice, not a need. And this gets right to the root of what's actually, taking place. And you can certainly symbolize it in all sorts of different ways. There's in infinite ways, really. But there's certain conventions in the world. Dzogchen Po Party. The Dzogchen Po Party. Or Dzogchen Pa. The Dzogchen Pa Party. One insight settles it all. I already clearly perceive perception's a choice, not a need. Wow. I'll make my own campaign speeches. That's it. That's my campaign speech right there. I'll make my own videos. I'll, fund it myself and, I'm running for president as the Dzogchen Pa Party candidate for I'm the Dzogchen Pa Party candidate for the president of the United States, and our guiding principle is super grace. Our motto is one insight settles it all, and our speech is I already clearly perceive that perception is a choice, not a need. So there you have it, right there, folks. Just keep practicing that. Just now and then, now the rest of the time, just wow that. Just wow it. So we give a little speech and then we wow it. Just sit there quietly and wow it. And so you can be non-aligned. People say, "Well, which way, your direction are you going? How are we going to fix failure this way or that way?" And say, "Well, I belong to the Dzogchenpa Party." And they have a candidate. I'm supporting the candidate, that candidate for president. Oh, really? Yeah. Okay. Diversity. Yeah. Okay. So you have a candidate. Yeah. What's their ideology? Well, super grace. Their principle, guiding principle, is they believe in super grace. Well, what's that? Well, the motto is one insight settles it all, complete redemption, all regrets washed away. One insight settles it all. And well, what can you expound upon that? Yeah, what we say is that I already clearly see, perceive that perception's a choice, not a need. And that's it in a nutshell, right there. Wow. So if elected president, we will have the country focus on that, on super grace, not on fixing failure. We don't need to fix failure, just set it down. Why do we need to fix failure? To keep it going? Yeah. I mean, We get we're tired of it. So how do we fix our boredom and tiredness with failure? We're really tired, and how do we fix that? Well, you know, juice up the interest, man. You know, come on, get into super. Now, here's an example, a very interesting example of, I'm telling you, being in shape is a good idea. I talked to someone today, and they, I said, "Are you working out?" I said, "Oh yeah." And he said, "I just did this Spartan." What do you call it? 9 mile race. It's called Spartan. It's a movement, a fitness movement, where you go through all sorts of obstacles, really difficult stuff. It's a Spartan race, it's called. And he told me, explained to me all the stuff you have to do. It's like, wow, very intense. I couldn't do it. I mean, you got to climb this really high rope. You got to go on this rope, long rope bridge, just a single rope, and you have to somehow go arm by arm and not fall or hook your legs over it. I mean, it's carry really heavy buckets of gravel up super steep hills and stuff. I could do that because of the workout I've been doing with my legs. So I could handle the leg part of it, but I couldn't really do the upper body part of it so much. But this is catching on, and this is a mania. This could very well become a mania in the world of this Spartan. Return to Spartanism, where you're like, you take on these really, and women are into it too, very much so. There's more men than women, but there's a lot of women doing this. They're ferociously in shape to handle the Spartan type of races now. It's not just, it used to be you'd had the 5K, you know, for breast cancer or something. And then, you know, then the triathlons were really, really popular, right? Swimming, running, and biking. A lot of people are really into those. Now I think it's the Spartan races are what people are really getting into now. There's all sorts of mud involved and barbed wire, and you know, they just put you through this torture test to see, you know, can you handle, are you a Spartan? You know, are you really a Spartan? Well, at my age, no. I don't have the upper body strength to do this stuff. But I could do the 9 mile. I could do the hills. That's like probably a piece of cake for me. I've never run long distances at all, but I'm sure I could schlep along somehow, right? Walk some, jog some, but as far as the hills go, oh, piece of cake. Yeah, I give me a heavy weight, I can carry it up a hill right now. I feel very confident I could do that. So I'm kind of like, yeah, I could do most of it, you know, probably. I could probably do most. I can't, man, not right, but I can't really do all of it, but that's okay because I'm in pretty good shape anyway. Whereas if you're really lousy shape, you might be awed by it and becomes a fixation in your mind and says, oh, this is a goal. I want to be able to do this race. And then you start really focusing on just that. Like this becomes your reason of encouragement to encourage yourself. You become fixated. Whereas for me, I just say, oh, yeah, it's interesting, but I'm not fixated on it. So I don't feel fixated on what's happening in the world. I'm aware of it a little bit. People tell me stuff from time to time. I say, yeah, you know. I might still keep working out, you know, upper body, lower body and stuff. But I don't feel like I have, maybe later I'll do a Spartan race. I don't feel like I have to do it right this moment. I kind of think, oh yeah, I'm working out, you know. But you could say, yeah, I'm working out towards it. And people say, oh, okay. But I'm not quite there yet. Not yet. Oh, okay, yeah. So you're not, it's like you don't dismiss it entirely. And they can see, oh, you're getting in shape. Oh, good. You know, okay. Maybe, you know, you'll be able to do that. And I say, yeah, maybe. And this sort of buys time. It sort of pushes things away from you. And right now we need to buy time as far as getting into the super grace, okay? We have to get into the super grace. Wow. I don't know. Altasa, I don't know what to do. Very interesting. People might be offended, or maybe not. Maybe they'll say ha ha ha. But it's not such a ha 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 thing. It's true. It's true. We are going into the most dangerous period in history, the most awkward period in history. Again, all we needed is that little blurb. Hispanic community goes from shock to action. You don't think that they're going, I mean, you don't know the Hispanic community, how cohesive they are. I sure do. And how galvanized they can be. If they decide to galvanize against something, they can shut this country down, actually. They really can. It's amazing. I mean, everybody's related in the Hispanic community. And they're generally not activists, but if they turn activist, we've never seen anything like it, probably. I mean, just look at Cesar Chavez and the United Farm Workers. I mean, they became extreme activists, didn't they? When they feel that there's something that really threatens them, they can become extremely activist. And there's so many of them in this country now. I don't know, 20 million maybe. Who knows? And they can become extremely cohesive, and they're way more disciplined than most activist groups. Like the African Americans, or you want to, blacks, or you want to call them, they, whatever they want to be called, I'm not sure, but they can be disciplined. They tend to get a little rowdy and start burning stuff, and things get kind of out of hand, and it brings bad publicity upon it all. And they can, but the Hispanics are different. So I suspect there's going to be civil disobedience, as I have pointed out ahead of time. I look for massive civil disobedience among the black culture, our African American culture, or among the Hispanic culture, feminist culture, gay culture, across the board. I think you're going to have massive rallies and marches and civil disobedience, basically threatening, telling everybody in the country, if you elect Trump, you're going to have 1,000 times worse. We're going to shut the whole country down. Complete civil disobedience. As you know, it's a intimidation factor. So we're going to have massive intimidation going forward. So instead of paying any attention to that, pay attention to the Dzogchenpa party and what they have to say. Instead of the Democratic Party, Republican Party, pay attention to the Dzogchenpa party. What does the Dzogchenpa party have to say? And maybe we can invite some Rinpoches and Tulkus to bless our party, Like, why not? I don't know if they do that. There's different types of, like in any situation, there's different types. Just like the Catholic Church, there's different types of priests. Some are wonderful. Some are like, kind of like real hard edge, like Jesuit types can be, very, kind of have this authoritarian edge to them, that they think that they're, they just know it all and they should rule the world or something. There's different personalities really come forth and like that. So, you just go with what you feel comfortable with, really. Different people like different styles. The monks have been raised in such a manner as they feel they're very, very skilled and knowledgeable, and but a lot of them are actually just positivist at this point. A lot of Tibetan what do you call them? Tulkus, Kenpos, Rinpoches, whatever you call them. They are positivists now. They've gone into positivism too much. They don't want to seem too much out of the mainstream, and they know that they see that positivism sells. It brings in money and support and acceptance. But if you just take the Dzogchenpa standpoint, you're not going to really integrate so well. I mean, they're trying to find a their culture. They're trying to make sure their culture survives. So they don't want to emphasize anything that could really just marginalize them too much. So they've gone into positivism. Dalai Lama talks about compassion, 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 compassion. And then later on he clarifies, they at least say, at the right moment to the right people. Well, what we mean by compassion is really, this view of Buddha mind. And our real goal is reach Buddha mind, okay? But they don't emphasize that. They emphasize good works, treating one another with compassion. Be kind to one another. Well, of course that sells. That's positivism. I'm not kind to others. I'm super graceful to others. It's different, totally different. I try to be super graceful, which is in the now with this unfixated viewpoint. I try to have an unfixated viewpoint. And see what arises from that. So, it's not just a syrupy compassion, good works, kindness, sob sister sort of thing of, no, not necessarily at all. I don't know what I'm going to do. So the Dalai Lama emphasizes the gradualist approach of working, was it Sarmitas or something, work on your qualities, your character. Be nice, be kind, be compassionate, don't get angry, tame the passions. This is the classic, Buddhist approach, whereas the Dzogchenpa approach is very different than that. It doesn't really worry about that. It just goes straight for the super grace and says, don't fixate any viewpoint. Don't fixate any viewpoint. Even the viewpoint of compassion, don't fixate on that, because that, as soon as you make that into a viewpoint, you become authoritarian and totalitarian, and it's a problem. Okay. Shut down. Let's shut down those ideologies in our minds, so we're not following them. I said, we don't really care. It's very helpful. We don't have to make a choice between those two. Otherwise, we think, well, I gotta make a choice. I better follow what's going along and decide. We're not making that choice. We're voting Dzogchenpa for president. Dzogchenpa for president. Maybe I should just say that, Dzogchenpa for president. Who's Dzogchenpa? Well, let me explain it to you. I'm the campaign manager for Dzogchenpa for president. I'm the figure, the spokesperson. I'm the official spokesperson for Dzogchenpa for president. That's what I'll do, say Dzogchenpa for president. Yeah. And people say, you're bloody eccentric. And I say, no, this is super grace, actually, which is what I've planned. I said this super grace is going to show up in the world. This is like an idea from super grace, and people are alarmed by it. They say, that's really weird and awkward. No, it's the antidote to the weird awkwardness. In other words, we're not following the awkwardness. Awkwardness is only awkward when you follow it. If you don't pay any attention to it at all, then your life can still be smooth. So we're not even going to pay attention to the election. All right? We're still going here? No. It stopped. What happened? I don't know. Everything's just frozen up. Okay. Froze up. No, it's still going. Again, having some problems with the software, but it's still going. Dzogchenpa for president. Yeah, that's it. Dzogchenpa for president. I'm voting for Dzogchenpa. Dzogchenpa. I'm voting for Dzogchenpa for president. We wear the red hats too, with the white emblem. Dzogchenpa for president. Dzogchenpa for president. Quote, one insight settles it all. The motto, one insight settles it all. The speech, I already clearly perceive. Perception's a choice, not a need. So maybe I can get some I don't know how you get people to visit, to follow a page, really on Facebook. I don't know, some people are good at it, but maybe we could follow, maybe we'll make a Dzogchenpa for president page. Dzogchenpa for president page. Facebook it. Maybe we'll get like a couple hundred, 100,000 friends or something, right? Likes, 100,000 likes. I'll start posting on that page. Wow. That's really something. That's quite an idea, isn't it? Very inspired idea. There's some people won't go along with it. There's some people who just feel they need to be iconoclastic no matter what happens. I'm not really one of those. I appreciate being iconoclastic. I certainly, but I'm more super pragmatic in that. You better get your attention off of what's going on, and the best way to do that is to get your attention on something better. Don't fight. Don't struggle against something. Turn your attention to something's better. Just like bad habits, don't struggle with them. Just start focusing on a good habit and put all your thought and attention into that good habit. This is really the way. This is really the way. Tsongkhapa for president and running for under the Tsongkhapa party. Clarity Ross is the official spokesperson of the Tsongkhapa party. Deal with the media, deal with the media, you know, deal with the inquiries, you know, do the web page stuff, you know. But where is Tsongkhapa? Tsongkhapa is this super grace. How does it show up? It shows up by saying, by practicing. If you want to see Tsongkhapa, practice this. I already clearly perceive that perception it is a choice, not a need. And when you do that, you will see Tsongkhapa, the candidate Tsongkhapa. Won't you? Yeah. Okay. Wow, that's a big wow. Like, wow. All right, so maybe I need to, what time is that? Yeah, maybe, we'll see. We'll see how I feel. I might do it. So once the Trump speech is over, we're going to have an alternative to both parties. And the awkwardness. It doesn't matter, you may favor one party, or that's fine, but the awkwardness, you want to avoid the awkwardness of it all. It's going to be very awkward now. And you can just say, I'm not even part of any of that. I'm supporting Tsongkhapa for president. And I will continue to support Tsongkhapa for president, whoever is elected. I'm going to continue on in this and promote this ideology, so eventually Tsongkhapa can become president. Not this election, the next, but we're going to just focus on working on that. And this helps those who, again, stay out of the awkwardness. Don't follow anything. I'm sure that pressure is going to be put on everyone right now. Insane pressure. How do you stand? You know, we want to understand. We want to know. And so, if someone asks you, well, how do you stand on the politics? Well, I'm the spokesperson for the Tsongkhapa party. Tsongkhapa for president. Tsongkhapa party. The candidate Tsongkhapa. So, I'd like to ask you, how do you stand on our, you know, my candidate? What? Yeah, how do you stand on my candidate, Tsongkhapa? Tsongkhapa, yeah. Well, what's their ideology? Is one insight settles it all. That we're completely redeemed by just one insight. Everything is settled like that. And the practice is what we want people to do. What do you do? What do we do? How do we fix things? What we do is we practice saying, I already clearly perceive that perception is a choice, not a need. So it's very simple. You know, anyone can do this. So I'm more interested in what feedback about my candidate. You see, so you flip the tables and turn the tables on him. He says, well, I got a candidate too. It's neither one of these. So we're putting some pressure on you to support our candidate. So this is a pretty interesting, inspired idea, actually. Tsongkhapa for president. What? What are you talking about? You crazy? No, not at all. A lot less crazy than the people who are supporting these other two candidates. I'll tell you that. Our candidate is way superior. Vastly superior. It's the candidate of super grace. Whereas you're just trying to have a candidate of grace to fix failure. So failure continues on effectively. You realize failure is inherently ineffective. So you want to try to find a way to boost the effectiveness of failure to recognize intrinsic spacious reality. So those are both terrible candidates, we'd say. I mean, you're supporting terrible candidates. What are you doing? We got a way better candidate. Much better. So it's not awkward, you know, it's because it's the right candidate. It's the right choice. Tsongkhapa for president. What does Tsongkhapa look like? Well, practicing. I I already clearly perceive that perception's a choice, not a need, and you will see Tsongkhapa face to face, which is what? In intrinsic spaciousness, you'll perceive that you don't need to perceive, you know, intrinsic spaciousness. Oh, you'll say, wow, you know, I love this candidate. Because what is the candidate? Freedom. Actual freedom. Okay. This is so intense, I don't know what to do. Oh, I don't know. Well, what can we do? We're not going to just sit and like flounder around like a fish out of water. You know, we're not going to do that. Whoever said I'm going to flounder around, I never promised I'd flounder around during these times. I never promised anyone I'd just flounder, right? They expect us just to flip and flop and flounder around like a beached fish. No, I got a lake I can go into. I got a lake. I can just smoothly swim in this lake, little nice little lake. Someone was going camping this weekend. They told me, and I knew where it was, and I said, wow, that's great, but there's no water. They said, no, they said there's a lake there. And I go, what? I didn't know that. They said, yeah, you got to hike to it, but there's a lake. I said, wow, that's great. I didn't know that. So there's a nice little lake where you don't expect there to be a lake, so you as a fish can be swimming around peacefully. They think that they've got us, you know, hemmed in to choosing between different styles of fixing failure. They don't have us hemmed in. The ego doesn't have us hemmed in. We can vote for Tsongkhapa. We can be affiliates, members of registered member. We don't have to register, but Facebook. We can register as a member of the Tsongkhapa Party. Come register as a member of the Tsongkhapa Party. So I'll see what I can do for us here. Okay, yeah. Wow, very intense. Okay, very great. Stop catcher. That's it. Or should I wait for 144? No, I'm not gonna do that. There's not 44s going on here.